This conference will now be recorded.
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Can you hear me?
Yes, yes, we can hear you.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, we can hear
Hello.
You. You are
ready. Okay. Thank you. Okay. So today we are going to discuss these two talks from 2019, October 2019. It is one is energy devices in vaginal therapy, and another is obstetrician's role in preventing cardiometabolic disorders. Both are short talks, so we will be finishing quite early. So coming to the energy devices in vaginal therapy. So this female pelvic floor, it is subjected to multiple physiological changes in adult life because of childbirth, aging, and menopause, also because of weight changes. So it will damage the pelvic floor, and the resulting manifestations can be either urinary or fecal incontinence, vaginal laxity, or prolapse. Also, these changes have devastating consequences on sexual function. Also, again, right now, because of all this internet and media explosion, the perceptions of normality of this vaginal or female genitalia, it has changed a lot. Okay, so these are the basically for this the vaginal surgery or vaginal rejuvenation, what it is called, it has been in great demand. So for this reason, in recent years, these energy-based devices which use this non-thermal energy, they have been increasingly used to address some of this pelvic floor dysfunction. And it is also used to alter the aesthetic appearance of female genitalia, which is called as vaginal rejuvenation. So this vaginal rejuvenation, it is a purely marketing term, okay? And it is usually, previously it was used to describe surgical procedures, but now it encompasses surgical plus non-surgical procedures, which are aimed at restoring the perceived optimum structure of female genitalia. Can you see this perceived word? Okay, so this is basically, it is a marketing gimmick for this vaginal rejuvenation or aesthetic vaginal surgery. The aim of vaginal rejuvenation, whether it is surgical or non-surgical, it's purely aesthetic. So which are the energy devices which are used for vaginal therapy? So one is the laser energy and another is radio frequency based devices. So in the laser, the CO2 laser and erbium yag laser, these are the two lasers which are used for this vaginal rejuvenation. Other lasers are not used, remember it's well. Okay, so it is a erbium yag laser and CO2 laser. These two lasers are only used for vaginal rejuvenation, and another is a radio frequency based device. So lasers either can be, they can be ablative or non-ablative. So CO2 laser is ablative, yag laser is non-ablative. Usually the settings are 3 to 4 settings, usually at 4 to 6 weeks intervals. Okay, now what is the mechanism of action of this energy devices? So in vaginal lasers, as I told you, these are CO2 and erbium yag lasers, while argon and KTP lasers, they are used for other purposes in gynecology. Lasers, these are named according to the medium that is activated. Each medium, it has a light wave of specific wavelengths. It will give a characteristic monochromatic appearance, okay? So it is a color, that is monochromatic appearance to that laser. So whenever you use the laser, the three parameters which decides the amount of energy delivered to that particular tissue is the wattage, another is time of application, and spot size of the beam. So in gynae, usual wattage which is used is 20 to 30 watts. time of application, it can be altered either by moving the beam back and forth or by selecting intermittent pulses. Okay, while spot size, it is altered by moving closer to the target. So this combination of watt and spot size, it determines the rate of tissue treatment. It is known as power density, and it is expressed as watts per centimeter square. So doubling the beam diameter, it will reduce the power by a quarter. So 1/4 decrease of the power, because you can see it is a centimeter square. Mechanism of action of this laser is to heat the connective tissue of the area which is being treated. So it will cause neocollagenesis, neovascularization, collagen contraction, and infiltration of growth factor. It will restore the elasticity and tone. It has a widespread application. So you can see the lasers are most commonly they are used in dermatology for aesthetic purposes. On the same principle, they are used in vaginal therapy. The use of these energy devices within a vagina is relatively a new concept. Various devices they are being used despite limited evidence for their efficacy. Radio frequency devices. The mechanism of action is they emit focused electromagnetic waves that generate the heat upon meeting tissue impedance. They have high penetration and lower operating procedures compared with laser. The skin surface is spared. Mechanism of action is similar to lasers, like they denature the existing collagen to stimulate production of new and shorter collagen, which causes this tissue tightening effect. So laser, as I told you, ablative or non-ablative. So CO2 is ablative, erbium yag is non-ablative. It can be fractioned or non-fractioned. So ablative sources, they vaporize the tissue layers, they are more aggressive, but they can have more dramatic results than non-ablative lasers. So non-ablative lasers, this leave the skin surface intact. Non-fractioned energy devices, they act on the entire projected surface of the skin. While fractioned, they target equally distributed portion of the projected area in pixelated fashion. So in vaginal treatment, the fraction lasers are used. Fractionated devices, these are used. Either ablative or non-ablative can be used. So fractionated lasers, they produce small columns of thermal energy. It is called as microthermal zones, which involve both epidermis and dermis in ablative lasers, or only dermis in non-ablative lasers. So the repair begins after the treatment, which will result in tissue changes, which we'll call it as neocollagenesis. Radio frequency systems which are used nowadays, they are non-ablative in nature. So indications for use of this energy devices in vagina, so they can be either for clinical or for aesthetic. So in clinically, genitourinary syndrome of the menopause, urinary incontinence, lichen sclerosis, and sexual dysfunction. These are indications for this vaginal energy devices. While purely aesthetic indications are vaginal laxity, labial skin laxity, and labial reduction. Risk and benefits of its treatment. So till now, FDA has not approved any energy-based device for vaginal rejuvenation, be it a laser or radio frequency. Okay, so it is not licensed for any vaginal symptoms of menopause, any incontinence or sexual function, because the safety and effectiveness has not been established. So these are not recommended ones. Okay, they are not licensed. But if you want to use it, you have to discuss the benefit and risk to all the patients, okay, and all also benefits and risk of all available treatments, okay. It is also advises clinician to report all adverse events through the usual systems. So what are the adverse effects they have found till now is vaginal burn, scarring, pain during intercourse, and recurring or chronic pelvic pain. But the overall risk is low, and less than 1% of women, they have this adverse effect. Rarely the adverse effects can be either permanent loss of sensation or pain on intercourse. It can be a rare effects of this, but the most common complication of this vaginal energy devices is dissatisfaction and failure to achieve desired effect. So these are the most common complications. This is regarding the vaginal energy devices. Basically that you should use which lasers are used, and these are not approved. That is the first thing that you should remember. Coming to the obstetrician's role in preventing cardiometabolic disease, which is also 2019 October talk. The non-communicable diseases, these are responsible for most premature deaths in women around the world. In UK, cardiovascular disease and stroke, these are the leading causes of death in women. Risk factor for CVD, like obesity, age, hypertension, diabetes, and renal disease. These are also associated with either gestational diabetes mellitus or hypertensive disorders of pregnancy. So all of these have a mostly common etiologies. And pregnancy, it is known as a cardiometabolic stress test. That means the physiological changes that occur in pregnancy, they usually unmask the subclinical conditions like diabetes or hypertension. This is an old concept, that is pregnancy as a cardiometabolic stress test. So whatever the hidden things are there, they will come out because of this changes, physiological changes of pregnancy. GDM and HDP, they will usually recede after pregnancy, but the woman remain at increased risk of type 2 diabetes and cardiovascular disease later in life. So history of pregnancy complication, it offers an opportunity to prevent cardiometabolic diseases. So here in this talk, they have particularly discussed regarding the GDM and hypertensive disorders only. So we will come to that. So maternal health risk after a pregnancy, which is complicated by GDM. So exact magnitude of risk varies among different population, and different definitions of GDM and type 2 diabetes also they exist. Various labels, they are proposed as various definitions. But the pooled risk of post-GDM type 2 diabetes mellitus is 7.43. And the cumulative incidence of type 2 diabetes is highest in first 3 to 6 years postpartum. So type 2 diabetes most commonly develops in first 3 to 6 years after the delivery. In meta-analysis of individual risk factors, what they have found is increased BMI, non-white ethnicity, family history of type 2 diabetes, insulin use during pregnancy, high OGTT values, early gestational age as diagnosis, they are all associated with higher risk of converting to type 2 diabetes. But maternal weight gain and birth weight, it does not appear to increase the risk. Globally, what they have found out, not gestational diabetes, but 1 to 6 pregnancies, they are affected by hyperglycemia. So hyperglycemia may not critically fit in the definition of GDM, but there will be somewhat hyperglycemia. So every 1 in 6 pregnancy is hyperglycemic. Women with GDM, they have double the risk of hypertension requiring medicine within 10 years of birth. Compared with women unaffected by GDM, women with GDM, they have also increased risk for coronary artery disease and stroke, and events are more common after 10 years. So increased risk of cardiovascular disease and stroke, it is common after 10 years. So it highlights that preventive interventions for CVD will need to be sustained over many years. So that education and that prevention is very important. Interestingly, only women with GDM who develop type 2 diabetes mellitus, they were at increased risk of microvascular complications, okay? So GDM per se, it is not increased risk of microvascular complication, but GDM which converts into type 2 diabetes mellitus, it is at increased risk of microvascular complications like vitrectomy, photocoagulation, that means retinal, diabetic retinopathy, renal diabetic nephropathy, and hospitalization for foot infection. So all these are microvascular complications. So how you have to prevent this type 2 DM after this gestational diabetes mellitus? So both intensive diet and exercise intervention and metformin. So diet plus exercise and metformin, both are effective in reducing the risk of type 2 diabetes mellitus. And breastfeeding is associated with reduced incidence of type 2 diabetes after pregnancies. What is the obstetrician's role in preventing this type 2 diabetes mellitus? So always obstetrician should communicate to women and their primary care providers that rate of progression to type 2 diabetes is highest within 3 to 6 years of GDM. This information also includes advice about postpartum and lifelong screening of type 2 diabetes, consistent dietary advice, and goals for minimizing weight gain during pregnancy and maximizing postpartum weight loss. Also, advice to reduce other risk factors of CVD like smoking and sedentary lifestyle. NICE 2015 guidelines for diabetes in pregnancy, it recommends that further screening of GDM for type 2 to diabetes. So they should offer diet and lifestyle advice and fasting blood glucose between 6 to 13 weeks postpartum, and then annual HbA1c as a screening test for type 2 diabetes mellitus. So it is a fasting blood glucose between 6 to 13 weeks postpartum. Remember, this is the most common last question. So further screening for type 2 diabetes for GDM is at 16 to 13 weeks, fasting blood glucose, and after that annual HbA1c. Reported screening test following GDM, it is between only 17 to 60%. Okay, so screening is very less in also UK also, because despite national guidelines, the screening rates remain poor. So best strategies are needed to improve the participation in the screening. Also, inclusion of BP and lipid profile testing with HbA1c, it is recommended for those who are at higher risk, like increased BMI, borderline dysglycemia, and strong family history. Also, those who needed insulin during pregnancy. So those are also checked for this cardiovascular diseases. That is, BP checking and lipid profile testing should be considered in those at highest risk patients. Now, maternal health risk after this hypertensive disorders of pregnancy. So women with preeclampsia, they have threefold increase in risk of hypertension in the years following the pregnancy. It is threefold women with preeclampsia. While recurrent preeclampsia, the risk is sixfold. Okay, so with recurrent preeclampsia, the risk of development of hypertension, it increases sixfold. Among women who are not having hypertensive prior to pregnancy, the highest risk of hypertension requiring medication within 10 years of birth, it occurs who develop preterm preeclampsia. Okay, so highest risk of hypertension which requires treatment, it occurs where the woman develops preterm preeclampsia. Also, the risk of hypertension is slightly higher in women with gestational hypertension than in preeclampsia. This is against our perceptions. What we think, preeclampsia is more dangerous than gestational hypertension. But it is not like that. Many studies have proved that gestational hypertension is associated with increased risk of development of further hypertension, okay, essential hypertension. So women with HDP, they are also 2 to 3 times increased risk of type 2 diabetes mellitus compared with normotensive. Preeclampsia, it doubles a woman's risk of ischemic heart disease and stroke. Actually, it is a misprint in, I think, TOG also. So it is an ischemic heart disease and stroke in the 10 years following pregnancy, with this risk continuing in the long term. So preeclampsia increases the risk of ischemic heart disease and stroke also. And usually it is a double risk. Risk of CVD is even greater in women who have both GDM and hypertensive disorders in pregnancy. So how to prevent this hypertension and cardiovascular disease after this hypertensive disorders of pregnancy? Now, here there is some unclarity. So situations are not very clear with this hypertensive disorders of pregnancy as good as a type 2 diabetes. So there you have a proper screening. They have advised proper screening, that is 6 to 13 weeks fasting blood glucose and annual HbA1c. But here, screening test, they have tested various screening tests like BP measurement, lipid profile measurement and all these. But no screening methods are recommended yet. So what they recommend now is the postpartum, the advice should be given regarding the screening and preventive measures. And also, so decreasing the risk factor, that means smoking cessation, weight loss, exercise, control of hypertension and hypercholesterolemia. So this is regarding preventing of risk factors, and also adoption of DASH diet. DASH diet means dietary approaches to stop hypertension. That includes fruit, vegetable and low fat dairy food. So it includes increasing the fruit, vegetable, low fat dairy food, whole grain, poultry, fish and nuts. So this should be increased with decrease in quantity of red meat, sweet, sugar-containing beverages, saturated fats and salt, and typical Western diet. So this is regarding this DASH diet. NICE recommends that women are made aware of this increased risk of hypertension and recurrent preeclampsia at 6 to 8 weeks postnatal visit. So this is the time for counseling. You may get SBA on this also. So when the woman should be made aware of this further risk. So it is at 6 to 8 weeks postpartum. Other screenings are not recommended yet. So obstetricians' role in preventing hypertension and cardiovascular disease for hypertensive disorders in pregnancy. As I told you, there are no screening methods yet. So it is basically that increase awareness. So they should be informed that they are at increased risk of hypertension and complications that may arise later in life. So this is regarding the talk of cardiometabolic disorders. Coming to the question, please type your answers in chat box. The 30-year-old, she has a third baby at 36 weeks following induced labor on account of preeclampsia. Her previous pregnancy is also complicated by preeclampsia. What would the effect of her recurrent preeclampsia on her risk of hypertension? Yeah, as I told you, single episode of preeclampsia, it will be threefold. The recurrent episode, it will be sixfold. So answer is D. Next one. NICE guideline for gestational diabetes recommends that affected women should be offered screening of type 2 diabetes. So what is this recommendation? Yes, again it is annual HbA1c, because see, you can see these two options are nearby, but it is not that. It is a fasting blood glucose at 6 to 13 weeks, otherwise it is annual HbA1c. So answer is D here again. Next one, for how long is the cumulative risk of type 2 diabetes is highest after pregnancy complicated by GDM? Yeah, it is again 3 to 6 years, correct? So answer is D. Yeah, so this is regarding today's talk. Tomorrow, no, it's Friday, tomorrow not possible. Saturday and Sunday we will do 2-2 again. Okay, so bye for now, we will meet on Saturday now.
Ma'am, hello.
Yes, Shreya.
Ma'am, regarding intrapartum mock test,
I will tell you in the group. Okay. Yeah, yes. Any other doubt?
No.
Okay, so thank you, bye for now.